Have you ever wondered what secrets lurk in your family's past? Have you ever thought you might be related to a celebrity, a tinker, a tailor, a soldier, a sailor, maybe even a thief? There was a time when a convict in the family tree was something to hide, a skeleton in the cupboard you wanted no one to see. But today, it's something of a badge of honour to have one in your ancestry. But perhaps it's even more prestigious today to have an Anzac in the family. My wife Robyn's family history can boast both. For not only does she have several Anzacs in her family, but also a fair dinkum convict who actually spent time in this very building, the Hyde Park Barracks, way back in 1839. The story of her family is one that's shared by many Australian families. So join us as we discover what shaped the lives of our ancestors and watch the story unfold. In a sense, it's the story of Australia. I'm sure we'll unearth plenty of secrets and surprises along the way. Seven generations ago, in 1838, Joseph Pengelly from Devon, England, was convicted of stealing a sheep to feed his starving family. He was given a 15-year sentence and was transported to New South Wales. He was one of 266 prisoners on the convict ship Teresa that arrived in Sydney in January 1839 and was processed at these Hyde Park barracks. But it was nearly 20 years before his wife and two children were able to join him in Australia, where they were able to forge a new life for themselves in country New South Wales. Joseph's great-granddaughter, Edna, married Robin's grandfather, Robert King, who served in the Great War, as did Robert's brother, Oliver. We knew it would be reasonably simple to find more service records on the Australian National Archives website. However, I'm going to get some professional help so that I can really understand what all these documents mean. Dr. Daniel Reynaud, Associate Professor of History at Avondale College of Higher Education, has studied the stories of many Anzac soldiers and will guide us through our search.
I'm interested in finding out about my family's Anzac history, and in particular my grandfather's service record.
Well, that's easily done. We go to the National Archives here, do a personal search, name search, name.
King, K-I-N-G.
1,265 kings served in the First World War. First name.
Conrad, which is a little bit unusual.
No Conrads, that's interesting. Now you mentioned family.
Yes.
So he's got brothers that
served?
Yes, yes.
Maybe we can track from there. Give me a name.
Oliver.
Oliver, okay. Here's Oliver.
Mm-hmm. Oliver Daniel.
Oliver Daniel.
That's him from Wee War.
Yes. That's right.
There's the man. Well, you can see here, you've got details about him. He joins up in 1914. He goes to Egypt and then to Gallipoli. Okay, now back to Conrad. Mm. He's not coming up. Is there anything else you can tell me that will help me find him?
Well, there is a family story that he did enlist with his younger brother, but before he was sent overseas, he read some religious literature and deserted.
Ah. Yeah.
Apparently, on reading the religious literature, he joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which encouraged the young men to serve their country but were morally opposed to killing. So he decided then that he would desert, leave the army, and he went selling religious literature for a year. But one of the church leaders, on hearing this, said, "Conrad, you've enlisted, you've made a commitment, you've made a promise, and you need to keep it." So he encouraged him to return and to re-enlist.
So he went back and enlisted.
So apparently then he would have gone back and enlisted.
Okay, now this is interesting, because if he goes back as Conrad King, he's going to be put in jail for deserting.
Yes, he is.
So I think he's enlisted under a false name.
So that would explain why there's no Conrad King
there. Okay, now, false name. With a name like King, he probably doesn't have to falsify that. We've just seen 1,265 of them. Mm. What's his middle name?
Robert,
okay.
And so he was known as Bob King.
He would have probably enlisted under Robert. Robert King. Let's see if this is him. Born in Melbourne.
No, born in Weewaw.
Yeah, like the family Ollie. Came from Weewaw.
Mm. Well, that makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, he's not going to say Weewaw.
They'd soon track him down.
They'd track him down. So, no, Melbourne makes sense. Yeah.
So this is him, isn't it?
This is him. In fact, if we click through, do you know where he lived in later life? Because here is an address.
We know that he lived in Currumbong.
That is Currumbong. Mm. This is him. We found your uncle.
That confirms it, doesn't it?
Yes.
We found your grandfather.
Ollie could have arrived in Egypt around the 25th of April, the day the Anzacs landed at Gallipoli. His time in Egypt would be short. Less than 2 weeks later, he landed at Gallipoli among the first reinforcements to make up for the losses during the landings.
Ollie landed here on the 7th of May 1915 and joined his battalion up in those hills on 400 Plateau. The battalion was defending a line at Wire Gully, the dip that cut the front line at Johnson's Jolly. But Ollie had only been on Gallipoli 8 days when he got into trouble, having twice volunteered for the long and dangerous hike to fetch items from the store here at the beach. He felt imposed on when asked to go a third time to collect a tin of biscuits. He swore at his sergeant and found himself under arrest and court-martialed for disobeying an order. He was sentenced to 48 days field punishment number 2, which meant hard labour. But his sentence was cut to 14 days due to good services in the field.
So, Daniel, was Ollie a bit of a larrikin?
Look, he probably was. But I think the situation's more of the Aussie fair go. Now, these soldiers tended to see themselves as civilians in uniform, and they thought that things ought to be done justly. Ollie's volunteered for a trip to the beach. He's done a second one. The sergeant said no more, and then he turns around and asks him for another one. So I think Ollie lost it, swore at the sergeant, but in fact he intended to do the trip. But it was too late. The sergeant had reported him, and he was up in front of the colonel.
So the good services that he did to have his sentence reduced in time down to 14 days, what would that have involved?
Look, to be honest, I think that's the colonel being diplomatic and wise. He probably recognised that it wasn't a serious situation, that Ollie wasn't really trying to disobey the sergeant. He just got caught out in a bad moment. So he's diplomatically found that these good services, which is just the routine things that Ollie was doing, he was a perfectly good trooper. He was fetching supplies from the stores, he did his job, he was basically a good soldier. And so the colonel found a way to let Ollie off while saving face for the sergeant.
But he does get 14 days of hard labour, and what would that have involved?
Well, probably any rotten job the colonel could think of, to be honest. And that probably was more trips to the supply store for poor old Ollie. This is Wire Gully, where a terrible battle was fought on the 18th, 19th of May. It's a Turkish counterattack, and Ollie was actually present at this battle. The Turks are coming in droves. They're trying to push the Australians back into the sea.
they have no cover at all, and they're shot down. Some of the Australians described it as being like a rabbit shoot. It was that easy. And at first there's this sense of exaltation, but then there's hundreds of bodies. There's wounded men that no one can get near because it's so exposed on both sides. And so the Australians are forced to listen to these men slowly die. And then the overwhelming, horrible stench of these bodies rotting in the sun.
So Ollie's in the trenches here.
Yes.
Firing his rifle.
Yes.
After the battle, what happens next? What is he involved with then?
Well, it gets so bad that the Turks negotiate with the Australians a truce to remove the dead. And Ollie's involved in going over this battleground, identifying the dead, having to go through their pockets and take out the identifying marks, letters, diaries, and then take the Turks to the Turkish side, the Australians to this side, to bury. And it is awful work, if you could imagine the smell. And often soldiers were stopping to retch from the horribleness of it. There is an absolute confrontation with how terrible war is at this place for Ollie.
So here Ollie is really confronted with the horror of war.
Absolute undiluted horror.
The soldiers' monotonous diet with insufficient fresh food and little water also added to the problems, and dysentery became widespread. On the 12th of July, Ollie was evacuated with debility to a hospital at Mudros, a Greek island off the coast of Gallipoli. His enteritis was so severe that he was transferred firstly to Malta and then to Britain, where it took over a year for him to recover. It was to be mid-September 1916 before he rejoined his battalion in Belgian Flanders. But within a couple of weeks, the battalion moved to the Somme for the winter, our next stop.
Now, I want you to imagine the living conditions here. Robyn, mm-hmm. In winter time.
Oh, cold.
It's cold. This isn't Aussie winter.
No.
It's a European winter. Frequently below zero, very wet, long darkness, hours of darkness, very little daylight, and the trenches fill up with water. They're constantly soaked. They can't have fires here, so they're cold, they're wet, they're miserable. Just appalling.
So there's no chance of drying out. When you're in the trench, you're wet.
You're wet.
Your feet are continually basically in water.
Not just your feet, but your whole body is wet, misty rain falling all the time, freezes at night.
So even when they were sleeping, they were still damp and...
Frequently they couldn't sleep because they were simply too cold to sleep.
Winter in the trenches was a trying situation. By this stage, the Great Battle of the Somme was in its final stages, and the grinding months of attacks through deep mud and hellish shell fire were dying away. Ollie's 3rd Battalion was not called on to participate in any attacks, but it was still an unhealthy place to be. Apart from German shelling, the trenches were wet, cold and muddy. After 4 months of trench duty, in early February 1917, Ollie was evacuated with trench foot, a condition caused by continuous wet feet, making them swell up and lose all sense of feeling. But the agony would hit in the ankles. Untreated, they would turn gangrenous and require amputation. He was sent to Brighton in England for extended treatment. It took 7 months before he was fit for active service again. He returned to his unit in France in September 1917, spending a couple more weeks in hospital there with a sprained ankle. In October 1917,
the battalion moved back to Belgian Flanders to participate in the last stages of the Battle of 3rd Ypres. Australian troops had taken part in several successful attacks associated with the Battle of Messines. And it was here that Ollie met his brother Robert one day by chance as their two units passed each other in the trenches.
You know, Gary, my father once told me that my grandfather met his brother unexpectedly in one of the trenches here. Don't you think that's amazing?
Well, it is amazing. You've got 100,000 Australians here and these two in different units. But they passed.
They must have passed as they were. One unit was leaving and one unit was coming in.
When would they have last seen each other?
Well, it would have been probably just before Ollie left Australia in late 1914.
So it would have been 2 years since they'd last seen.
A bit more than 2 years.
Just amazing. Yeah. And imagine a chance meeting out here in these trenches.
Yeah.
I wonder how they would have felt.
Well, I would have rushed up and given them a big hug, but...
But I'm sure they would have been just overjoyed at seeing each other and the relief at knowing that they were still both alive.
Yeah, well, I remember reading the diary of a soldier who had his brother in his own unit, and he was saying it was always a worry because they're in the same battles together and he was always worried about his brother. Mm. So separate units helped a soldier focus a bit better.
What a wonderful occasion, though, this chance meeting.
Yeah.
And what joy it must have brought them.
Now, Robyn, there is one more thing about this place that might be significant.
Tell me.
Well, your grandfather is a pioneer. And this here was originally a German bunker with the guns facing that way towards the Allies. But when it's been captured, the Australian pioneers are asked to turn it around to face the other way. So you can see here these corrugations from the corrugated iron where they poured the concrete, so that it was now facing in a new direction. And you've got the machine gun apertures on either side. So this was the work of Australian pioneers, and perhaps, who knows?
Could have been my grandfather.
It could have been your grandfather.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah. To think we're right here where he may have been involved in constructing something like this.
Yep.
It's just amazing to be here.
Soon after, at the Battle of Broodseend, Ollie was gravely wounded in the head and back by a shell and evacuated to Brighton again for extended treatment. It was effectively the end of Ollie's war.
Meanwhile, Ollie's brother Robert was still in Belgium as part of the 1st Pioneer Battalion.
So, Daniel, what's the difference between a pioneer soldier and a normal one?
Well, a normal soldier is an infantryman. It's their job to attack, capture, and hold. But they're not specialists in building things. When they capture a trench, they'll dig it out, but the pioneers will come along, they'll put in the corrugated iron, the A-frame, the duck boards, so that it's a proper trench.
Which we would call a boardwalk.
You would, but it's a duck board to keep their feet up out of the water.
So they didn't get trench foot.
Aha. And, of course, they would build things like this. This is an elephant shelter, and it's designed to keep soldiers safe in a bombardment. So, basically, a pioneer has got woodworking skills, metalworking skills, or engineering skills. Does that sort of fit the profile of your grandfather?
I think he was good at choosing the correct wood for construction.
So he's a specialist in woodwork?
In woodwork.
Now, I wonder if he actually helped build the underground bunkers at Zonnebeke, because we know the Australians built these wooden underground bunkers and they were recently rediscovered. And he very well might have been one of those woodworking specialists.
If he was good with the wood.
He was in this area.
So, Daniel, it sounds as if it's hard work that he would have been involved with, but not necessarily dangerous.
Well, not necessarily, but pioneers were consolidating immediately after an attack. They're building new concrete bunkers. They're very exposed very often. So there's nothing necessarily safe about being a pioneer. It's a job where many men could be killed.
So my grandfather was willing to die for his country, but not to kill.
That's a really interesting point that you make, because speaking historically, there were a lot of soldiers of conviction, usually religious conviction, who felt that the gospel meant that they were not to kill other people. It's the gospel of peace. Jesus was prepared to die to save people, but he wasn't prepared to kill. And there were many Christians who in the army chose either the medical corps or the pioneers precisely for that reason.
That so they maybe that's why he chose the pioneers.
Yes, given the backstory that he found God just as he joined up. The pioneers is a place where he can contribute, he can help his fellow men, but he's not in a position where he needs to take life.
Yes.
Then in August 1918, the 1st Pioneer Battalion was sent south to the Somme to join in the great offensive that pushed the Germans back to the point where they sued for peace. Robert was involved in preparations for the string of successful battles that General John Monash and the Australian Corps achieved during this time. Robert was here at Hamel, Monash's model battle. Here he helped prepare the positions for the attack and then build new defences after its successful conclusion.
Here's the situation, Gary. On that ridge over there, just over the horizon, Villers Bretonneux, which the Australians have recaptured. And now Monash plans a battle with the Australian Corps to recapture this whole valley, the village of Hamel, right through to the ridge on our left. Now what he does is he has a battle of all arms. He integrates and incorporates the infantry, pioneers, machine guns, artillery, tanks, aircraft, all working in cooperation. And he breaks through the German defences. Some stubborn resistance in the centre of the village, but on either side they're able to break through and then consolidate on that ridge.
So it's a perfect battle.
Perfect battle. He planned it to be 90 minutes long, hour and a half, and it took 93. It was such a successful battle that they printed the plans for the battle and distributed it to other generals as a template by which to operate.
And so Robert, although he didn't carry a rifle, still played an important role in this battle.
He would have helped prepare the jump-off positions, and then at the end, he would have been there improving the hasty trenches that the soldiers had dug and making sure that everything was ship-shaped. So from beginning to end, he would have been under artillery fire from the Germans' machine gun fire as he helped get this vital work done.
Then from here, it was following the trail of the victorious Australian troops through to St. Quentin. His work involved building new roads, maintenance, and burying the dead, both German and Australian, as well as constructing dummy tanks from wooden canvas to deceive the German troops. But the Australians were pulled out of the line in early October, and Robert's war was over. Daniel, was that the end of the war for all the Australians?
Pretty much, yes. In October, the Australians are pulled out of the line, and by the 11th of November, the war is over.
And in general, what's the Australians' contribution to the war? What did they achieve by being here?
Look, it was increasingly significant. By 1918, the Australians are among the elite troops on the Western Front, alongside the Canadians and certain British divisions. They're used to crack the line repeatedly throughout the second half of 1918. So it is an important contribution.
Now, more specifically, what about Robert and Ollie? What did they achieve?
Well, they were present for some of those key battles throughout the war. Ollie's at Gallipoli, he's at 3rd Ypres, and Robert is present during the 100 days, the final destruction of the German army on the Western Front. So, yes, they were there at key points in the story. Now, Ollie, of course, is frequently sick and away from the line. In fact, he probably spends more time away than he does at the front. But that is typical of the experience of many Australian soldiers.
Well, we're back here at Hyde Park Barracks where we started. This is where our journey began. In 1839, Joseph Pengelly
arrived here as a convict. But he resolved to make a new life for himself in Australia. Ironically, instead of stealing sheep, he established a sheep farm of his own in central New South Wales and became a well-respected citizen of the community. His great-granddaughter married Robin's grandfather, Conrad Robert King, the Anzac whose footsteps we've been following.
Conrad died many years before I was born, and so to me, he was just a photo in the old green family album. But now we've uncovered the mysteries behind the old photos. We have travelled far to unravel their stories.
Dear Father, our family history shows the debt we owe to those who fought great battles for Australia and New Zealand, what commitment they showed to their country and their beliefs. May we honour their memory by imitating them and building on the Christian foundation they have given us.
We have a wonderful offer for all our It Is Written viewers today. If you'd like to explore more about the Anzacs and their experiences with God, each chapter of this book, The Faith of the Anzacs, contains inspirational stories of our fighting men as they worshipped, prayed, sang, and trusted God in the hell of Gallipoli. Treat yourself to these stories that will lift your spirits and lead your own thoughts to a faith that works in the trials and tests of life. And there's more. We will also include a DVD called Fighting Mac, The Man the Anzacs Idolized. All you have to do is call or write. Here's the information you need.
Phone 1300 300 389 or phone 0800 It Is Written to request today's free offer. So don't delay. Phone 1300 300 389 or phone 0800 It Is Written. If you'd like to support this ministry, please send your donations to PO Box 1115 Wurunga, New South Wales 2076 Australia or PO Box 76137 Manukau City, Auckland, New Zealand. So don't delay. Call 1300 300 389 or 0800 It Is Written to request today's free offer. Call us now.
If you've been inspired by this special commemorative Anzac program, be sure to join us again next week when It Is Written will present another new and thought-provoking perspective on the peace, insight, understanding and hope that only the Bible can give us. It Is Written truly is changing lives around the world. Until next week, remember, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God.